A key question within the field of mental health sciences is how are we going to cope with and adapt to the likely mental health impact of COVID-19 upon the population? The mental health community have mobilised with an incredible speed and efficiency to ensure that the support that's required currently is available. But they've also mobilised to ensure that appropriate data collection methods are underway. Several position papers have been published, which outline what the research priorities are in this space now and into the future. It's really important for us as a mental health community to understand exactly the impact that COVID-19 is having on the mental health of the population, but also to understand exactly who needs the support, in what circumstances, and what type of support is required. And then, of course, if that support is fit for purpose. So my lab studies the field of psychotraumatology. This is essentially the study of stressful, adverse or traumatic life experiences on the mental health of people within the population. Therefore, it stands to reason that we're really interested in the impact that COVID-19 is having on the mental health of the UK population. So on March 23rd, we launched the COVID-19 psychological wellbeing study across the four nations of the UK. This launch coincided with the day that the UK Prime Minister announced that every person in the UK should stay at home unless they had a very specific or essential reason to leave. So essentially, this was the first official day of the UK lockdown. There is prior evidence that when restrictions such as quarantine and social isolation are put into place, that this does indeed impact on people's mental health and wellbeing. So to date, in our COVID-19 psychological wellbeing study, we've collected data from over 2,500 people living within the UK. Several hundred people continue to complete assessments on a weekly or monthly basis. So the question is, well, what are we doing with this data now that we have it? Well, myself and my team are based here in Northern Ireland, and therefore we felt it was important to interrogate the 470 responses that we received also from people living in Northern Ireland. So far, we've concluded from the data that 30% of those responding to our survey are reporting symptoms that would be indicative of a generalised anxiety disorder. 33% of those responding to our survey are reporting symptoms that indicate a major depressive disorder, and 20% are reporting symptoms that indicate a post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, it's important when you have figures like this that you're able to make some comparisons. So we can go to the Northern Ireland Study for Health and Stress, which was a population-wide survey conducted between 2004 and 2008. They also produced some figures around these common mental health disorders, and they reported that in Northern Ireland, 4.4% of the population met the criteria for generalised anxiety disorder, 16.3% met the criteria for major depressive disorder, and 8.8% met the criteria for post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, it's really difficult that we make comparisons across studies or that we make direct comparisons. And this is because sometimes we use different measures of people's psychological symptoms, or we might ask people to report their symptoms across a different time span. So the Northern Ireland Study for Health and Stress reported symptoms across people's lifetime, whereas in our study, we asked people to report their symptoms across the past 2 weeks or the past month. So you can see how some comparisons might be difficult. There is some work going on in the UK related to COVID-19 psychological wellbeing, a similar study to our own. And this study has reported that of all of their respondents across the UK, approximately 22% of them were reporting symptoms that indicated a generalised anxiety disorder or a major depressive disorder. And in that study, approximately 17% of their population were reporting symptoms that would indicate a post-traumatic stress disorder. So you can see that there's similar results coming out from these studies. But the good thing about the work that we do is that we can also collect information about socio-demographics. So we can look at what particular factors or particular demographics might predict who will or who won't have one of these mental health outcomes. So we found a general trend in our data based in Northern Ireland, whereby vulnerability for mental health outcomes was indicated by being younger aged, by people who had a pre-existing mental health condition, those who were engaging at a very high rate with social and traditional media, and also those who were really concerned about being infected by COVID-19. We also found that those who were employed in one of the key worker roles as assigned by the government were more likely to have a mental health outcome than those who were not. So now that we have this information, it's really important that we use it to actually help people with mental health across the population. And therefore we need to use it to improve the outreach of services. So we need to ensure that outreach of services meets the needs of those people who need them. And therefore we need to ensure that we try to get services to hard to reach populations. We also need to prioritise the evaluation of therapeutic interventions that are available to treat these common mental health issues. And also we need to look at how effective these are when they're delivered on digital platforms. The government officials should look at funding plans for the enhancement of the mental health workforce. And indeed, the Department of Health in Northern Ireland just launched a mental health action plan containing 38 action points. But it's really important that to ensure that we cope with and adapt from the mental health impact of COVID-19, that the mental health strategy in Northern Ireland is well coordinated, well resourced, addresses those in hard to reach groups, and ensures appropriate workforce planning to ease the pressure on mental health workers.